Would you please welcome Shane Curran to the stage here, please? Thanks a million, Shane. So rather than me try to explain what Evervault is and does, I'd like to start there because I think it's really important that people know about the company and what you're trying to achieve.
Sure. So data privacy, as you all know, is a really, really big problem. Everyone who's building applications these days, whether it's software or any other kind of piece of technology, is thinking about it. But the toolkit for baking it into your product from day one is just frankly pretty crap. So what we do is we build developer tools and make it really easy for software engineers and product builders to bake privacy into their product from day one, all in a couple lines of code. So insanely, you can charge your credit card in a couple of seconds using companies like Stripe. You can ensure data privacy in a couple of seconds using Evervault. And that's the premise of what we're working on.
Yeah, it's an amazing idea. And is the idea that it almost democratizes those platforms?
Yeah, for sure. It entirely democratizes it in the sense that consumers are the ultimate owners of their data. We provide the infrastructure on the internet to allow them to do that.
Shane is actually going to be speaking at Future Human in May, so you'd be very interested to meet Brittney Kaiser at that event. I think you might have met her before, have you?
Not that I know of.
Oh, okay. You'll meet her in May in any case. But she has she was formerly the business development officer for Cambridge Analytica, and she became a whistleblower, and now she runs an organization called Own Your Own Data. So one of the nice things is those kind of connections are really important. Sequoia Capital, I mean, huge name, and the likes of Stripe and all the rest of it. How on earth did you, you know, at 19, end up in touch with those sort of players?
There's obviously a very decent lineage of portfolio companies that they've had. For me, it was entirely kind of serendipitous in that I'd spent a year going around Europe trying to raise venture capital from the firms around here. I pulled together a few offers, but decided I just wasn't really happy. And I think a lot of the time, venture capital in Europe is entirely, or can often hinder the companies that they invest in and sort of stop them from going on to be, you know, $10 billion companies just based on the structure and the the kind of way that they invest. So I was actually going over on a camping trip with a load of other young founders in Napa Valley, which is just north of San Francisco. And I had a couple of extra days either end of it. But signed up for office hours with another fund called Andreessen Horowitz, who again have invested in a lot of those companies through in Stripe as well. And just met them for 20 minutes, genuinely just looking for advice because I'd secured offers from European funds. And the following day, I woke up with an email that just basically said in the subject line, "Coffee with Sequoia?" And I was like, okay, might as well. So I met them the following day, and they had heard that I'd met with Andreessen Horowitz because although San Francisco is a city with, I think, in around 1 million people, the venture capital industry is tiny, and the associate network just, they share deal flow like crazy. So met them, they had heard about this meeting, and within about a week had turned around an offer, and we closed about a week later, so that would have been towards the end of last summer, and since then we've kind of started to grow.
It's kind of an unbelievable story. It's a wonderful story out of Ireland, and you're based here in Dublin.
We do all our product work here in Dublin, all the kind of go-to-market and stuff we're establishing over in San Francisco. I spend a decent chunk of my time out there, but we're an Irish company.
It's just funny having this conversation with a 19-year-old. I love the way you were saying we were kind of, I was going around Europe looking for VC, but tell me a little bit more of the journey, the way you do when you're 18 at the time, probably, were you? Tell me a little bit more of the journey from, actually, maybe even start with BT Young Scientist, because I assume that was a pretty good launch pad. It gives you a bit of credibility, I imagine.
For sure. I mean, my last year of the Young Scientist was 2017. They didn't let me enter again because once you enter a winning project, sadly, that's the one restriction is you can't enter again. Entered that, and that would have been when I was in fifth year in secondary school. So I still had a lot of work to do, had my leaving cert. Gave senior cup rugby a stab as well. Didn't work out so well. So spent a couple of years just kind of being, you know, being kind of a normal enough teenager. But in my spare time over the Easter holidays, I'd begun to kind of spend more and more time over in San Francisco. During the Easter break before the leaving cert, I hopped on a plane over to San Francisco and just decided to meet with the Irish Mafia over there, who are all, you know, extremely helpful. You know, some of whom were, you know, have ties with the Young Scientists, like Patrick Collison from Stripe, for example.
Literally the Mafia, by the way.
Actually, it basically is. This is the thing. It's like,
I know what you mean by the Irish Mafia. But
yeah. There's definitely closeness to the Sicilian Mafia, but yeah. Yeah, I went over and kind of like tried to thread that needle between the leaving cert and kind of growing a large company, or you know, what hopefully we will be over time. I remember I went to Magaluf after my leaving cert in 2018.
The way you do, yeah.
Yeah, like every other 18-year-old. And I was out in the balcony, and there was a DJ playing. It was Tiny Tampa or someone. It was at like sort of noon, and I was on a conference call with a professional services firm. And it was a video call, so I put on a shirt, and I probably had shorts and like sandals on underneath or something. Was on that phone call, and they do these sort of sound checks in the morning. And these sort of smoke machines make an extremely loud noise when there's no crowd there. So it's kind of halfway through the phone call, and then all of a sudden it's just this massive like whoosh of smoke. So I just sort of excuse it on a bad line or whatever, and just decided, okay, I'll just hang up here and pretend the call dropped. So definitely had like and my friends were like at the same time sort of tapping on the window to make sure I was, you know, still alive or whatever. I definitely tried to kind of balance the two of them together. But slightly different.
I mean, something I don't know if people realize as well is how much the likes of Kate and Annie and yourself come back here. Like, you're not just here today to be with us.
No, we can't escape this place, even if we wanted to. It's hard to get away from. No, they, a lot of the sort of like the alumni, as we're called, get together pretty frequently, and we're all pretty good friends. We're brought back every year to lug furniture around and put up posters and everything. So, the mundanity is always fun.
I love that. But I mean, I think it's amazing to come back and you know, what goes around comes around. I think it's good karma, apart from anything else, to come back and help
out. And we really enjoy
it.
Well, I do anyway. Yeah. So, I'm not complaining at all.
Did you make a load of friends through the BT Young Scientist?
Lots, yeah. A lot of my really good friends are from the Young Scientist. There's just a really strong group. And I think that's, I was having a discussion earlier on about how the Young Scientist is basically just this one place where everyone can kind of unload their inner kind of nerdiness, and it seems cool. It's just this weird kind of like countercultural thing. So everyone just kind of becomes friends instantly straight away, and there's groups of us that get together all the time now.
Yeah, fantastic. Well, listen, I mean, I'm not going to keep you terribly long because it's only a short lunchtime event. But I mean, will you tell me a little bit about what your ambitions are for Evervault? Yeah. Where do you want it to go? Do you want it to be global? Are you looking at Asia? Are you very much focused on the States?
So we're pretty calculated in the way we're going after it. Where we want to be as a company is, given the size of the problem of data privacy, we want to build, you know, one of the biggest companies in the world. And you know, given the backing that we've taken on, it's hard to kind of escape that ambition and that desire. So we're looking at the States initially. It's a good kind of test bed to get the go-to-market right. But you know, our plans are entirely global. I think our approach to kind of solving problems is probably a little bit different to what a lot of European companies do in that. They'll sort of look at a set of companies, find a lot of specific problems that they have, and try to build sort of a solution that fits into all of those. For us, we're basically defining the rules of how we think data privacy as a problem should be solved, regardless of what we do as a company. We even wrote a manifesto called the Pragmatic Privacy Manifesto, which, although we execute on and our products kind of keep that in mind, regardless of what we do, we hope other kind of people and other companies take into account when they're building things and trying to solve the problem. We want to build a $100 billion company plus.
That's all. Okay. Yeah. World domination. I love it. Listen, thanks a million for telling us a little bit about it here today. I'm really excited to have you back in May and to
Cheers,
hear more
yeah.
about
Looking
it.
Forward to it.
And God alone knows what you'll have done by then, but we shall see. So can I have a round of applause there for Shane?
Thank you.
Thanks a million.
Thanks.